büyüteceğiz merak etmeyin. So this is basically now a simple model or the simplest model that we are going to see throughout this first half of the semester. First of all, so it's going to be a benchmark economy. It's going to be a very simple model, a one period model. In that sense, it's going to be a static model. And we'll start slow and consider this one period world. Of course, I will be talking about the setup a little bit, the underlying assumptions behind the choice of the utility functions, production functions, etc. And so this is going to be a very simple model of a one period world. This is lecture1.pdf, which I have already shared with you. Lecture2.pdf is already shared with you. If time permits today, and I think it will, we will also start lecture 2. It's going to be basically discussing a two-period world, which is a much more realistic environment, as you are going to see. Now, let's start. I very much, so these lecture notes, really, I tried to write them very pedagogically or as pedagogic as I can be. So please read them. You know, these are, you know, during the lecture, we may sometimes, you know, certain a step, jump from one step to another, but please read the lecture notes after the lecture or before the lecture, preferably even. Anyway, so in this world, we will have a representative, first of all, household. So let's look at the agents of this economy. And the first agent is going to be the representative household. It is representative. And again, this is the assumption that especially heterodox economists criticize quite a lot, rightfully actually. But so this is the simplest model. So when you start learning economic modeling and macroeconomic theory, of course you should start with the very, very simple model first. It doesn't make sense to see the most complicated model out there and just start with the discussion of it. So even though, you know, we are starting in a with a model of representative household, actually, I think you are going to do it next semester in EC 504. You are going to be introduced heterogeneous agent models where you do not have a representative household and instead you have different agents, different households, which may differ in different dimensions, such as their utility functions might be different, their endowments might be different, etc., etc. So, you know, they might be different. But right now, we have a representative household. Even these simple models can explain certain facts, as we are going to see later on. Now, let's look at the assumptions here. So we have a representative household here that enjoys consumption of some composite goods. We lose the define it as consumption. And there is one good here, again, for the sake of simplicity, but you can just think of it as a composite good of including millions of other consumption goods. But the representative household gets utility from two things. One, consumption. Two, leisure. Leisure is the time that you devote to leisure activities, you know, going to a fun park, sleeping, you know, reading a book maybe for fun, watching Netflix, spending time with family and friends, etc., etc. And both of these variables, both C0 and L0, so they do have subscript 0 because it denotes that we are in period 0. Period 0 is the only period in this model, by the way. We are starting to count from 0 in a two-period world. In lecture2.pdf, it's going to be period 0 and period 1. Here, it's just period 0. The household has no exogenous income. However, first, like, there are two sources of income for the household. One, it has fixed time and capital endowments. So first of all, it has fixed capital endowments. So the household borns basically to life, comes to life with some capital endowment available, whatever that physical capital is. And one way to earn income for the household is going to be to rent this capital to the firm so that the firm can use it for production. So in this world, firms don't own the capital. Instead, households are going to own the capital and they are going to be renting it to the firm. And of course, when the firm rents capital from the household, it's going to pay a rental rate. It's going to basically create a source of income for the household, this capital endowment. That capital endowment we are going to denote by K0, K sub 0. Okay, this is the physical capital endowment available to the household, and it's exogenous. K0 is exogenous. So K0 is given, so in a sense, like it just falls from tree or from sky, whatever you think of, or maybe the household inherits it from his parents, grandparents, whatsoever, you can think of it like that. But it's just an exogenous source of physical capital available to the firm, available to the household, and the household can rent a fraction of it, can choose to rent a fraction of it, or maybe the whole capital to the firm to be used in productive activities. Another endowment that the household has, in addition to the physical capital, K0, is H, and H is time. H denotes time. To rent, for example, if this is a daily model, so the periods denote a day, it's just 24 hours available to the household. Or if it is a yearly model, where each period corresponds to a year, it's the total available time in a year. Okay? And the household can choose, we'll see, so the household is endowed with time equal to H, and it can use it for two purposes. Leisure, if the household wants to enjoy leisure out of the available time, then it's going to bring direct utility because leisure enters the utility function. Two, if the household chooses to work in the labor market, some time can be devoted to work, and then through that, the household can earn some labor income. So basically, that brings us to the budget constraint of the household here, where we have C0 being equal to W0 times H minus L0 plus R0 times KH0. Now, be careful here, so the notations. So C0 is consumption. And consumption is sort of, in a sense, the spending side of the budget constraint. And the right-hand side is the revenue side of the budget constraint. And what do we have in the revenue side? We have W0. W0 is basically the wage rate, real wage rate in that period. H minus L0 is time minus leisure. So basically, it is labor supply. Time minus leisure, it denotes labor supply. It denotes labor supply. And also another thing that should basically attract your attention here is we now have in the subscript NH0, not N0. Why? Because we are going to differentiate between NH0 and later on NF0. Why? Because NH0 denotes labor supplied by the household. NF0 is going to denote labor demanded by the firm. When there is labor market equilibrium, they are going to be equal to each other, if we have a labor market equilibrium. But theoretically, they can be different. That's why we use two different notations for them, NH0 and F0. Similarly, the second source of income for the household is R0 times KH0. R0 is the rental rate of capital in that period. KH0 is here, is the capital the household rents to the representative firm. Now, you may be wondering why we do not use K0 here, because remember, we said the household is endowed with K0. So why don't we just put K0 here? We can, but theoretically, we just allow household to have a KH0 that can be between 0 and K0. For example, let me just annotate here. You'll see what do I mean by this, maybe. Notation chain are double there. Evet, ilginç bir şekilde annotasyon şeyimiz yok. Menüsü kayboldu burada da. Neyse, burada annotate edebiliyordum da kendimce şimdi burada nedense I don't see the annotation tab in Zoom, which was actually a very useful tab, but I don't know why it does not show up here. Bir dakika. Bir saniye. Şuna bir bakalım. Niye hiç gözükmüyor annotation? Bir daha share edelim. Allah Allah. İlginç. Allah Allah. Annotasyon gözükmüyor. Okay, anyway. So what Ya normalde Zoom'un, kusura bakma yanlış şey, biraz da duraksadım. Çünkü Zoom'da böyle bir annotation diye bir özellik vardı. Ve annotation özelliğinde ben PDF'in üzerine güzelce yazıp çizebiliyordum.
Hocam siz adminseniz yapabilirsiniz ama belki siz
Ne yaparsam
yetkili
yapabilirim?
olmayabilirsiniz. Eğer adminseniz yapabiliyorsunuz, anotasyon görünüyor ama değilseniz görünmüyor diye biliyorum.
Ben admin'sin derken hostum yani ben.
Eğer hostsanız evet görmeniz lazım aslında
Bu
yukarıdan.
gözüküyor ilginç şekilde. Yani yok şu anda annotation
Hocam
görünemiyor.
belki ayarlarda enabled yapmanız gerekiyor diye biliyorum.
Ha.
Belki disabledsa
Yok,
bu
zaten
kısım.
yani default'ta available yani, Allah Allah.
Belki değişmiş olabilir.
Bir saniye, pardon, çok özür diliyorum ama bir dakika bana izin verin o zaman. İlginç ya. Yani annotation'ın olmaması kadar saçma bir şey olabilir mi? Olabilir tabii de. Şimdi burada ayarlara falan bakıyorum da neyse, yani tamam, bunu çözüm buluruz bir şekilde de, hani normalde var. Acaba şeyi değiştirsem, bir dakika. Hesap değiştireyim bir dakika. Şimdi switch account etsem acaba o zaman olacak mı? Yani acaba bonus hesabındaki bir saçmalıktan kaynaklanıyor olabilir mi diyorum. Bir saniye arkadaşlar. Çözeceğiz işi. İnşallah yani. Saniye. Farklı bir hesaba girmeye çalışıyorum da. Tamam mı? Gerçi şimdi şey olabilir mi? Bir dakika. Birinizi bir host yapalım. Alp'i burada ilk görüyorum ama bir co-host yapayım ben. Nasıl gibi de tabii şey... Ha, bir dakika. Zaten çok da önemli değil. Yani. It's not very crucial that we use the annotation tool, but it yok. Annotation yok. Farklı bir hesap için açıp muhtemelen meeting'i belki baştan başlatmak falan gerekiyor. Bilmiyorum da neyse. Şimdi artık uzatmayalım o zaman. Tekrar ben eski hesabıma geri gideyim. Daha düne kadar olan, yani daha dün bir meeting yaptık arkadaşlar. Orada vardı yani. Niye? Gerçi işte Boğaziçi hesabıyla girmedim ona yani. Onunla alakası yok. Neyse, bilmiyorum. Okay, so I'm sorry for the lack of the annotation tool now. And by the way, our attendance is going up. We are now 17. Okay. Okay, let me not use the annotation tool, but if I could have used the annotation tool, I would basically be writing, typing the following here. So, KH0 is the capital rented to firms, and it should be between 0 and K0. So basically, theoretically speaking, the household can choose what fraction of the total available capital to rent. It can choose to rent the whole capital, it can choose to rent zero capital. Of course, here in this model, since renting capital to the firm does not have a cost, and actually just the opposite, it brings benefits here in terms of additional income, of course, in equilibrium, KH0 is going to be equal to K0. But again, theoretically speaking, we can differentiate between KH0 and K0. And also, we will also have KF0. That's going to be capital rented by firms. But again, in equilibrium, KH0 is going to be equal to KF0, and both of them are going to be equal to K0. Is this clear? Is this small nuance maybe? Is this clear to everyone? Please, by the way, if you have any questions at any point, don't hesitate to interrupt me and ask. And please ask if something is not clear. Her şey clear. Okay. Then, so we can now look at the utility maximization problem. Ah, before we go to the utility maximization problem, one more thing that I want to emphasize here is, if you look at this budget constraint carefully, please look at it carefully. So C0 is equal to W0 times H minus L0, blah, blah, blah. So if you have, notice this negative component here, minus W0 L0, and assume that we take this negative component to the left-hand side. So if we take this minus W0 L0 to the left-hand side, what's going to happen? It's going to be C0 plus W0 times L0 equal to W0 times H plus R0 KH0. What does it mean? So when we rewrite the budget constraint, when we rewrite the budget constraint such that this W0 L0 now shows up as a positive term on the left-hand side. Why do we do that? Because it basically shows us that leisure is a good that has a price equal to W. always say this, you know, here we treat leisure as a good that a price that is a price equal to W, because theoretically speaking, you can basically work 24 hours a day. So let's say your hourly wage is W0, and you can use all the available time to you. You can use it for work, theoretically speaking. And then you can start buying leisure out of your own time. It is why when W0 times L0 shows up as a positive term on the left-hand side here, it basically means that as if you are paying for L0. And actually, you are paying for L0. If you think of it like as an opportunity cost, you know, if you spend leisure, it means that you don't work. So you give up wage income that you could have earned otherwise. Right? So that is why we are going to actually, leisure is a good that has a price equal to W. And actually, if you remember the differentiation of goods with respect to their behavior to income, like normal goods versus inferior goods. Do you remember that from principles, intermediate courses? Normal goods and inferior. Normal goods are goods that you consume more if you have more income. Inferior goods are goods that you consume less with more income, right? And leisure is a normal good that has a price equal to W actually. Okay? Leisure is a normal good. Now, why am I emphasizing this? You know, leisure is a good, it has a price equal to W. I am emphasizing it because it's going to become clear on the next page. Now, let's look at the complete utility maximization problem first. So this is the complete utility maximization problem here. That is basically involving maximizing utility subject to budget constraint, time constraint, and other non-negativity constraints. So here we allow the household to maximize utility function that includes consumption and leisure as choice variables. But the choice variables, as you know, it's notation-wise, you write choice variables in an optimization problem under the maximum operator. And then you have the budget constraint. Theoretically speaking, budget constraint should be satisfied like with a less than or equal to sign, but let's just, you know, get rid of it for the sake of simplicity. Let's just have equal sign here. We have non-negativity of consumption condition here. We have non-negativity of leisure condition, as well as the condition that leisure cannot exceed total available time. And then we have this condition that the capital rented from the household to the firm should be between 0 and K0. Okay? Of course, just writing this problem does not guarantee that a solution exists. And also, even better, the solution is unique. So, because generally, again, in economics, we are always after unique solutions or unique equilibriums. Equilibriums doğru olmadı. Equilibriumun çoğu da equilibria. Equilibria, evet. Latince'de öyle bir şey var. Hani mesela ne bileyim, datum. Datum is a Latin word. The plural of which is data, right? And equilibrium, equilibria. Anyway, very minor information. But here, so we really want to avoid environments that lead to multiple equilibria or multiple solutions. We don't want to do this because then if you have multiple equilibria, you don't really know which one you are going to focus on. You don't really know with respect to which one you are going to do a policy recommendation, policy exercise. You know, it really complicates our life. So we are always, you know, we have this sort of unique equilibrium sort of fetishism in economics. And that necessitates making some assumptions to establish, to ensure the existence. Also, it is also not guaranteed that a solution exists to this problem. If you have a very weird utility function, yes, you might end up with a problem where you don't have a solution to this maximization problem. So the solution, for example, may involve infinity consumption. Like, of course, not here because there is this budget constraint. But theoretically speaking, if you have a very weird utility function, it might be the case that there is no solution to this problem. So to have a solution, plus to have a unique solution, we impose certain conditions. I am not going to be going over them one by one, but like generally speaking, it's the utility function, if the utility function is strictly increasing, strictly concave in both of the arguments, and to avoid the corner solutions again, if you assume the existence of so-called in other conditions where like the partial derivatives jump to infinity in the corners basically. So if you have this, and then this first and the second order conditions on the utility function with respect to both of the choice variables, then yes, this problem has an interior solution, and also it's unique. Of course, just relaxing one of these assumptions does not mean that the problem will not have a solution. It may, but it's simply not guaranteed. So that is why we are using this kind of utility functions. Cobb-Douglas utility function, for example, is, let's say, C to the power of alpha Liouville to the power of 1 minus alpha. It's going to satisfy these conditions. It's one of the functions that is okay to be used. Or a logarithmic function, log C plus E times log Liouville, you know, a coefficient times log Liouville. It's going to satisfy these conditions. There are some exercises here, and then you can look at those to see that these conditions are satisfied. Now, of course, later on, when we have more complicated models now, to characterize the solution to the utility maximization problem, we will use Lagrangians, you know, form a Lagrangian, take derivatives, partial derivatives, make them equal to zero, and then manipulate them a little bit. But for now, for this very simple one-period model, actually, it is going to be enough if you remember your intermediate micro, or even sometimes principles of micro courses, where you might have seen, you know, the budget constraint, indifference curve, and, you know, optimum solution occurs at the tangency of the budget constraint with the indifference curve. Do you remember that? Tangency of the budget constraint with the indifference curve. Hatırlıyorsunuz değil mi? You know, in a two good model, good X, good Y, the household is trying to optimizing. You know, you draw the nice indifference curves, which are convex according to the origin, you know, banded. And then the budget constraint, you've tried to find the tangency. Now, tangency means what? Tangency of the indifference curve and the budget constraint means what? It means that the optimum allocation is on the budget constraint, first of all. It should satisfy the formula of the budget constraint since it's going to be on the budget constraint, condition one. Condition two, since it's a tangency, at that particular point, the slope of the indifference curve is going to be equal to the slope of the budget constraint, right? Now, the question here is, what is the slope of the indifference curve? Again, you might remember from 101 or 203 intermediate and or principles of micro that the slope of the indifference curve is nothing but the ratio of marginal utilities. Do you remember that? The slope of the indifference curve is defined as the MRS, by the way, marginal rate of substitution. Right, the definition of marginal rate of substitution was, of course, it's the rate at which you substitute good X with good Y and also keeping the same utility level. That was the definition of marginal rate of substitution, but that is nothing but the slope of the indifference curve. And the slope of the indifference curve, again, you might remember from these courses, that is equal to the ratio of marginal utilities, that is the ratio of the utility function's partial derivative with respect to good X divided by the partial derivative of the utility function with respect to good Y. Here, our good X and good Y are going to be leisure and consumption. Remember, I told you leisure is a good. So if you want to, for example, visualize this environment, then we would put leisure on the x-axis, consumption on the y-axis, and then we can draw our budget constraint, indifference curve, et cetera, et cetera. So basically, that is why at the optimum, MRS between leisure and consumption, that is equal to the ratio of marginal utilities with respect to leisure and consumption, will be equal to the price ratio. Remember, in the optimum, because the budget constraint slope was equal to price ratio. Again, you might remember from intermediate or principles of micro that the slope of the budget constraint is equal to minus px divided by py. Değil mi? Hatırlıyorsunuzdur. Çok uzun yıllar olmadı yani. Not long time has passed since then. So minus px over py. So what is Px and Py here? Look at the budget constraint. I told you if you put leisure to the left-hand side as a positive term, C0 plus W0 times R0. So basically the leisure's price is equal to W0. What is the consumption's price? We just normalize it to one here. As we can see, there is a one here, which is invisible, but there is a one here. There is a coefficient of one before the consumption. So it is one. Therefore, Px over Py, or minus Px over minus Px over Py in our world is going to be nothing but W0. Of course, you can just get rid of the minus signs, both from the ratio of marginal utilities and this, but that is what it is. And if you cross multiply now, you have this condition over here. U sub L minus W0 times U sub C is equal to zero. This is a very famous equation, and it has a special name. It's not written here, but I can now tell you. The name of this condition is intratemporal condition. Intratemporal condition. Intratemporal. Intratemporal means within time. Later on in a two-period model, we will have an intertemporal condition. Intertemporal condition is going to mean between time. We are going to deal with it later in lecture two. But now this is called intratemporal condition because in this condition, we have the same time subscripts everywhere. So we have subscript zero, subscript zero, subscript zero, subscript zero, and subscript zero. It's a condition within that particular period. And it has an intuitive meaning. Like all equations in macro have intuitive meanings. It's just sometimes they don't seem that easy, but they have intuitive meanings. What is the intuition behind this equation? It is basically this equation here. Also, generally, all optimality conditions in economics, they illustrate a trade-off. What trade-off? Here the trade-off is between the following. So the consumer faces the following trade-off. Should I work one more period? But if I work one more period, I lose leisure. Or instead, should I use my time for one more unit of leisure? How should I divide my time? Should I work? Should I enjoy leisure? If I work, I have some labor income and enjoy more consumption thanks to that. But if I don't, I have more leisure. So, for example, if you reduce leisure by one unit, by 1 hour, for example, you lose this. But what do you gain? You gain, so you work one more hour, therefore you earn W0. With W0, you can buy W0 more consumption because consumption's price is equal to one. And with W0 more consumption, your utility increases by W0 times U sub C. So if you work one more hour, you lose this amount, but you gain this amount. And in equilibrium, they should be equal to each other. If they are not equal to each other, if one of them is larger than the other, let's say this equation is not equal to zero, instead this component is larger than this component, so this equation is larger than zero. In this case, by enjoying more leisure, you can increase your utility because enjoying more leisure, you earn this, you lose this, but since this is bigger than the second component, your utility is going to be going up, and it means that you were not maximizing your utility in the first place. But maximizing utility means, so you have the maximum solution, there is no other allocation that you can increase your utility. But if this component is larger than this component, it means that by increasing your leisure, you can enjoy more utility. And it means also at the same time that you were not maximizing utility in the first place. Okay? Arkadaşlar burada videolarımızı açmaya çalışalım mümkünse. Bu ders böyle samimi olsun. Ben sizin gözlerinize bakarak anlayıp anlamadığınızı da görmeye çalışıyorum bir yandan. Sınıfta olmuyor, sınıf gibi olmuyor biliyorum ama please turn on your video cameras. I have to see your eyes. And from your eyes I generally can tell whether you get the material or not. Alp, sen de lütfen açabilirsen çok memnun olurum. Any questions until this point? Okay. So now remember, we are trying to solve the utility maximization problem. And we are trying to solve, what does it mean solving the utility maximization problem? It means finding out, you know, in, again, from intermediate or principles of micro, you can remember, solving a utility maximization problem means that you need to find out the coordinates of this tangency. Finding the coordinates of the tangency means finding the x value and the y value of the tangency point of the indifference and budget constraint. So it basically requires you to find values for two unknowns, the amount of good x, the amount of good y. Here, it is the same. The amount of consumption and the amount of leisure we need to find. So we have two unknowns. And for two unknowns, generally, of course, you can basically solve them with even maybe one equation or sometimes three equation can also determine. But generally speaking, the number of equations should be equal to the number of unknowns under certain conditions. And here, for two unknowns, we are going to be needing two equations. And two equations, remember again from these earlier courses, one equation is the formula for the budget constraint itself because the optimum allocation is on the budget constraint. And the second equation is going to be the tangency between the budget constraint and the indifference curve. That means the equality of the slopes, or not from the equality of the slopes, we basically have obtained this. So this basically two equations, two unknowns are C0 and L0. And two equations here are going to be this equation, the intratemporal condition 1.10, and the budget constraint itself 1.11. Here, we just set KH0 to K0, by the way. You might be wondering because I already told you that renting capital does not have a cost for the household. Therefore, And by the way, now I see that more people have turned off your cameras. Yusuf Dik, Mehmet Burak Akren, please turn on your cameras. And Alp Aydın, please. Duyuyor musunuz beni arkadaşlar? Yusuf, Mehmet Burak ve Alp. Duymuyorsunuz galiba.
Açtım ben.
Açtınız mı? Tamam. Peki Alp sanırım duymuyor. Çünkü eve uyardı kendisini o zaman dersten. Gönderelim şimdilik. Nasıl o şeyde dinler diye düşünüyoruz o zaman. Yine Yusuf sen duyuyor musun bizi? Duymuyorsun. O zaman seni de gönderiyoruz. Tamam. Bu noktadan dinler arkadaşlarımız dersi. Okay, so this is basic all, like the two equations, two unknowns. Now, is this enough to solve the system? There is an example here, example 1.3. Let me just very quickly go over it. We have this utility function, Cobb-Douglas, C to the power of 0.5, L to the power of 0.5. H is given, total time is given. W0 is given. R0 is given. K0 is given. And the question is asking you basically, can you solve for optimum consumption and leisure? So what you need to do is that you need to form this system of two equations and two unknowns. What is this first equation? The first equation is the intratemporal condition. Intratemporal condition is U sub L0, so the partial derivative of the utility function with respect to leisure, times W0, times the partial derivative of the utility function with respect to C0 is equal to zero. And then if you rearrange this equation, it really gets simplified as you can see. Now you can just put an equality sign here, multiply with L0 to the power of 1/2, both sides of the equation. You can cancel the 1/2s. You can multiply both sides of the equation by C0 to the power of 1/2. You end up with this. This is equation number one. This is a simplified version of the intratemporal condition. And then what you do is, you know, in a two equations, two unknown system, you solve for one of the variables in terms of the other using one equation, plug it back to the second equation. The second equation is the budget constraint. If you take this simplified expression coming out of the intratemporal condition and plug it back to the budget constraint, you have this. So you just solve for L0. L0 is apparently kaçmış? 9. 9. L0 is equal to 9. And then C0 is equal to 7 times L0, 63. And N80 is 14 minus Liege, it is 5. So you can just solve this utility maximization problem. Okay? Is this clear to everyone? Evet, clear diye anlıyorum.
NH0 is not equal to 24.
Why is what not equal to what?
NH0, NH0.
Not it is H, it is H minus L. And H was given to be 14. Okay. L is equal to total time minus leisure. Total time is 14. It's not 24. Because we don't know what total time symbolizes here. And you can repeat the same exercise to get an analytical solution. If you have a utility function like this, and H is equal to a constant number H0, K is equal to K0, W is equal to W0, you can just show that the optimum bundles are like this. You can get the formula for the solution to consumption and leisure. In the first homework, you are going to do it. You will solve this exercise. You can do some comparative statistics exercise. You know, you can look at the derivative of consumption with respect to W, leisure, whatever. You can do it on your own. Now we come to the second agent of the economy. That's the representative firm. So the second agent is now, and you will see, by the way, in the subsequent lecture notes as well, in a competitive economy, we will always proceed like first discussing the consumer side, then discussing the firm side, and then bring consumers and firm together in a general equilibrium setting. Okay? Now, here, the representative firm's problem is like this. So, we are assuming that there is a representative firm. Again, you can have heterogeneous firm, but not earlier than EC 544, I guess. And that's going to be employed with a constant returns to scale production function. We discussed that a bit last week, like the CRS function is needed here again. Otherwise, increasing returns to scale, decreasing returns to scale, they lead to negative or positive profits. And we have the definition of CRS here. You can just read it on your own. So, but what we have is that the firm is producing output. KF0 is the capital rented by the firm. And F0 is labor hired by the firm. Z0 is the total factor productivity. And the profit maximizing labor demand is basically that marginal products are equal to the respective prices. That basically, again, I'm sure that you have seen that intermediate macro. You also need to have the inertia conditions here. And again, the first derivative should be positive, second derivative should be negative for a unique solution to exist to the profit maximization problem. And then if you write down the firm's optimization problem like this one over here, profits are equal to output minus rental costs for capital and labor costs. And capital and labor should be non-negative. And the first order conditions basically then imply that marginal product of capital is equal to the rental rate of capital, marginal product of labor is equal to the real wage rate. Not surprising. Again, these are actually trade-offs again. You know, like here the trade-off is, should I hire one more labor or not? If I hire one more unit of labor, my firm gets this as an additional benefit. If I hire an additional worker, I pay this to him or her. And in equilibrium, they should be equal. If one of them is larger, it means that I was not maximizing profits in the first place. Okay. And CRS implies zero profits. You can just show it, like we discussed this last time a little bit, you might remember. But please read those things, okay? These are really nice side comments over here. Buraya geçiyorum. Bunları okursunuz. Please read those. Burada da hatta güzel bir soru var. Buna da bakın. Now, so as I told you, as I promised, now we are going to bring firms and households together. And we are going to define our first competitive equilibrium here. Competitive equilibrium here, by the way, competitive means that both the household and the firm are price takers. That's an important issue. So when the firm is maximizing profits, it takes R and W as given. It cannot influence them by changing its labor demand, for example. Of course, under a monopoly or under a monopsony, this is not the case, obviously, or even under an oligopoly, imperfect competition, this is not the case. Under these imperfect market structures, firms can influence market price. They have market power, so to speak. Here it's a competitive equilibrium. Firms are atomistic. So small compared to the size of the market, they cannot influence, affect market price by changing their quantity. So competitive means this. And equilibrium basically means that all markets clear. It's actually general equilibrium. I'm going to tell you in a minute. All markets clear. And how many markets do we have here and how do they clear? We are going to discuss. Let us discuss now actually here. How many markets do we have in this economy? So first of all, we have the capital market through which households make rental capital available to firms and firms rent them. Market two, labor market. Households supply labor, firms hire labor. Market three, goods market. Firms produce output, households consume them. So there are three markets here, capital markets, labor markets, goods market. And you, I don't know whether you have heard about that, but those of you who have heard famous Walras theorem, Walras, Léon Walras, French economist of 19th century, who was influential in creating the construct of general equilibrium. The Walras theorem basically suggests that if you have n markets in an economy, and if n minus one of them are in equilibrium, the nth market, the last market, is automatically in equilibrium. So equilibrium in n minus one markets guaranteed equilibrium in n markets. So here, since we have three markets in this model, equilibrium in two of them guaranteed equilibrium in the third one. We will be discussing this later on. Okay? Let's look at this competitive equilibrium. Do you want me to give a break in our online lectures? Do you? İki kişi başını sallıyor. Do you? Yani you do. Pardon, özür dilerim. Yeah, so you want to give a break. Değil mi? Öyle mi anlıyorum? Doğru mu? Bir ses verin. Yes, no. No diyen var mı? Yani anyone says no to giving a break? Yok. Tamam. Let's give, ama çok da break vermeyelim böyle 10 dakika. İstiyorsanız 48 geçiyor. Let's give a 7 minute break and let's meet at 10:55. Let's wash your faces. Go to restroom if you need. Drink a glass of water. 10:55 we are going to meet here. Okay? Okay, I'm back now. Hopefully you are too. Annotation işinde sanırım hallettim ama tabii şimdi şey buna evet yani şu an hali hazırda devam eden bir meeting de yapamayacağız galiba. Zoom'un asıl sitesine girip oradan açmak gerekiyor. Ama normalde yani açıktı ne zaman kapandı da yeniden açmak gerekiyor onu anlayamadım. Açık olan bir şey ne zaman kim kapattı da ne oldu böyle oldu anlamadım. Neyse. Okay, let us continue. So now we are basically Orhan, Mustafa, Cener ve Tayhan, sizleri de alalım. Daha fazla öğrenci de çıkartmak istemiyorum dersten ama ya bu bizim, neyse, Ünal Hoca'nın önerdiği bir şeydi. Ben de bir yapayım dedim ama hayatımda ilk defa dersten öğrenci atıyorum böyle. Tabii çok da burada bir tuşla atabiliyorsun. Çok kolay. Sınıftaki kadar böyle daha zor değil ama üzüldüm de arkadaşlar içinde bir yandan ama neyse, sonuçta panoptadan dinlerler. Ama hani biraz ben şey, tabii kamera açmamak da mesela, hani şey olsa anlarım. Hocam işte müsait değilim, şöyle bir durum var. Kamerayı o yüzden açabiliyorum, açamıyorum dediklerinde sıkıntı yok da kendilerine seslenmemize rağmen cevap vermeyince insan da bu sefer ben burada boşuna mı anlatıyorum diye bir şey oluyor, üzülüyor. Neyse. So now we are bringing two agents of the economy, the firms and the consumers together under the concept called competitive equilibrium. So let us define a competitive equilibrium first, because definition is very important, by the way. I remember, for example, when I was a PhD student at the University of Minnesota, in fall 2005, in my first year. So again, in the PhD program, courses are divided into two. First half taught by different professors, second half another professor. The first half was taught by Tim Kehoe, who is still a very active professor at the program in Minnesota. And Tim Kehoe was really very hesitant. He was really emphasizing quite a lot for us to know how to define an equilibrium. And he was deducting points, for example, in the exam, if you misdefine the equilibrium, because knowing to define an equilibrium is in a sense like it's half of the solving for the equilibrium. Okay, so you cannot properly solve for the equilibrium values without understanding first how to define it. That's key. Like, which variable is exogenous? Which variable is endogenous? Now, one thing that I really want to emphasize here is, now in the firm's problem, when we look at the firm's profit maximization problem only, firms are price takers. They take R and W as given and behave accordingly. So they take the prices as given, try to maximize their profits. Households, when they solve their utility maximization problem, they take prices given and solve their problem accordingly. However, this does not mean, so both firms and both households, even though both of them take prices as given, this does not mean that prices are exogenous in the model. No, prices are endogenous. Why? By taking them as given, by behaving accordingly, prices are automatically determined endogenously to within the model. How? We are going to see an example. So let's look at the definition first. Given K0, Z0, H, given this exogenous parameters, K0, Z0, H, K0 is given, yani initial capital from your parents, grandparents, from falling from the sky, apples falling from the trees, whatever, they are given. Z0 TFP parameter is given, H time is given. Tamam, Berfu'yu da almış olalım bu arada. Geldi galiba Berfu'da. Hoş geldin tekrar Berfu. Kusura bakma az önceki şey için ama sana da tekrar buradan da söyleyeyim. Hani daha evet, yani belki işte bir 5 dakikalık işim vardı falan da işte ben de burada tek başıma anlatırken kapalı olunca, bir de sana seslendik birkaç kere birkaç dakika arayla. Ses çıkmayınca dinlemediğin hissine kapılıp mailini aldım bu arada. Dinlemediğin hissine kapılıp öyle bir şey oldu. Normalde dediğim gibi ben öyle sınıftan öğrenci göndermek hayatımda hiç yaptığım bir şey değil. İlk defa yapıyorum burada ama işte ne bileyim bizde de neyse boş ver. Tamam, gergin günlerden tamam, geçiyor. Yok,
problem değil hocam.
Tamam, peki. Barışalım yani. Kötü olmasın. Daha dönemin başında.
Sağ olun hocam. Teşekkürler.
Burada bir arkadaşı daha gönderdik ama o nerede bilmiyorum şimdi. O e-mail de yazmadı. O da o arada gümbürtüye gitti. Şimdi adını da unuttum.
O da yeni girmeye ama galiba atılacaklar giremiyorum falan demişti.
Ne demişti? Pardon Hüseyin, anlamadım.
Yeniden girmeyi denemiş ama atılınca sanırım yeniden link çalışmıyor falan dedi yani. Ama almıyormuş kimsenin.
Hocam hesapla giremiyor atıldığı için. Ben o yüzden farklı bir hesapla deneyip girdim.
Ay Allah, öyle bir de zorluk mu varmış? Tamam, neyse, ben onu da bilmiyorum. Kusura bakmayın tekrar.
Bugün o hesapla bir daha giremez yani.
Ya sadece bu derse giremez tabii ama değil mi? Başka derslere girebilir tabii ki.
Yani bu linkle bir daha girer mi bilmiyorum.
Oo, hadi ya, o kadar şey yani. Bütün...
Ondan emin değilim yani. Emin değilim aynen, ne aynen. Kadar acaba bir restoration o, koyuyor ama.
Bir değiştiririz, tamam. Olmadı linki değiştiririz. Sorun yok, tamam peki. Bir daha da bunu yapmayalım. Siz de işte kameranızda en azından yani ara veriyoruz zaten 5 dakikalık ara. Tuvaletti, suydu, şuydu, buydu ihtiyacınız olduğunda şey yaparsınız.
Tamam hocam.
Tamam mı?
Tamam hocam.
Okay, so now we are looking at the definition of the competitive equilibrium. Where we have this given parameters. Then we say, so given these parameters, exogenous parameters of the economy, a competitive equilibrium consists of prices. Now, as we can see now, we have a new superscript here, here E, because this is not any prices. These are equilibrium prices. So that is why we are denoting them by E. Of course, sometimes, you know, you may want to denote them with an asterisk sign if you want, but or maybe in a with a bar sign or whatever, or with a tilde sign. It's up to you, but you have to denote it in a special way to show the reader that these are not any arbitrary prices, but these are equilibrium prices. Why? Because only the equilibrium prices solve this competitive equilibrium. Like, for example, here, you cannot put R0. If you put R0 here, it means that any R0 can solve it. But no, any R0 cannot solve it. Only equilibrium prices constitute a competitive equilibrium. Only under equilibrium prices, demand is equal to supply, for example, in the labor market, or demand is equal to supply in the capital market. So, consists of equilibrium prices, equilibrium allocations of the household, consumption, leisure, labor, equilibrium allocations of the firm, capital, labor, output. Such that, one, the consumer or the household solves the utility maximization problem, basically, in words. Then, two, the firm solves the profit maximization problem. Three, all markets clear or general equilibrium conditions. What does it mean? Capital market equilibrium, capital available to firms and being used by firms for rental purposes is equal to the capital rented by firms. Labor supplied by households is equal to labor demanded by firms. Consumption consumed by households is equal to the output produced by firms. Or not firms, firm, by the firm. There is one firm. I told you that so there are three markets here, all of them clear. But actually writing all is extraneous. Like you don't need to write all the three conditions. Actually, later on we'll show just writing these two equations already implies, for example, the third one. So you don't need that. This is just you do not have to write the third equation here. That's what I'm trying to say. But of course, you know, it's also not a big issue if you choose to write it. Competitive equilibrium. Now we go to the characterization of the competitive equilibrium. By the way, the word characterization is an important word in macro. Characterizing means forming the system of equations that are sufficient to solve the system, to solve the problem. For example, characterization of utility maximization problem means show me the equations that will be needed to solve for the unknowns. Don't solve them. You know, if I, for example, if in the exam, if I ask you characterize the competitive equilibrium, it means show me the equations that are needed to solve the system. But don't solve. I'm not asking you to solve. I'm just asking you to characterize. Characterize means this. You know, just tell me the analytical equations. Give me an analytical description of what is needed to solve the system. If I don't say it solve, you don't need to solve. This is the characterization of the profit maximization problem here, characterizing the profit maximizing labor demand or other demands. It's just these two equations. These are the characterizing conditions. There is no solution here as you can see. It just tells me without assuming a specific production function, you cannot solve it of course, but it's just a characterization. And here similarly, the character, now if you come to competitive equilibrium, characterizing the competitive equilibrium means that you need to show me the equations needed to solve the competitive equilibrium. That is quite simple, as you are going to see. One is, it's going to be basically the same, intratemporal condition and the budget constraint eventually, but let's see how we are going to be sort of manifest them in a very slightly different way. So first of all, as we know, what does this competitive equilibrium mean? Competitive equilibrium is, we have the utility maximization problem on the one side, we have the profit maximization problem on the other side, and these two entities, these two agents of the economy, they interact. They interact, you know, with each other, and that's how the competitive equilibrium is formed. So in a sense, what we should do is, maybe, like, given this intuition, we should look at the solution to the, or the characterization to the utility maximization problem first, then characterization to the profit maximization problem next, and then somehow find a way to combine them. Let's look at the household's problem, the utility maximization problem. It's given here. You have the intratemporal condition, and you have the budget constraint, right? Of course, you know, we are writing them in equilibrium values here, equilibrium prices. That's the only difference. So these two equations are nothing but the two equations that characterize the utility maximization problem. Similarly, these two equations are nothing but the equations that characterize the profit maximization problem. And we have the capital market clearing, we have the labor market clearing. So since we have this capital and labor market clearing, now it is time to not to use two different notations for NH and NF, instead just use N0. So first, if you do that, you can also do the for K0. K0, you know, don't use KF anymore, just use K0. So now what happens is, the budget constraint now is like this, like it's now W0E, N0E, not NH0 anymore. Again, nothing but the budget constraint. This is again nothing but the marginal product equal to R equation, but here, as you can see, we do not use KF0 or NF0. Instead, we just use K0 and N0. Similarly here. Okay? Now, how can we combine the two problems? How can we combine the characterization of the utility maximization problem with the characterization of the profit maximization problem? One way to combine is going to be, if you look at the intratemporal condition, where you see W0, you can plug in marginal product of labor, because W0 in equilibrium should be equal to marginal product of labor. That's actually what we do here. If you combine 3.1, the intratemporal condition, with the one of the profit maximizing condition of the firm, you end up with this. What is this? It is still the intratemporal condition, U sub L minus W, but W is now equal to marginal product of labor times U sub C equal to zero. Okay? Another interesting, so this is the first combination. The second combination is going to be combining the profit maximizing condition, or the so-called zero profit condition, since it's a CLS function, with the budget constraint. To see this, first of all, zero profit condition means what? Revenue is equal to cost. What is revenue? It's the output. The price is normalized to one, you know, so output is equal to revenue. What are the total costs for the firm? Capital cost plus labor cost, right? So now what happens is, if you now take this equation here, cost being equal to output, plug into the budget constraint. In the budget constraint, we have capital income and labor income. Now instead of capital income and labor income, you can just write output. So then the budget constraint becomes output equal to consumption. Oh, this is nothing but the goods market equilibrium condition, right? So this equation is nothing but the goods market equilibrium condition. It is why actually I told you, you know, when we defined the competitive equilibrium, I told you that the last equation, output equal to consumption equation, is extraneous, meaning you don't really need it because all the other conditions above it basically implied, or this Walras theorem already implied. So that is why you don't have to write it, because if you combine the zero profit condition with the budget constraint generally, you end up with it anyway. But here it's nothing but consumption equal to output condition. By the way, so this consumption equal to output condition, you have seen it actually before. Do you remember this famous national income accounting equation? Y is equal to C plus I plus G plus X minus M. Herkes hatırlıyordur. Y eşittir C artı I artı G artı X eksi M. So this equation, we now have a very simplified word here. Like, we do not have an open economy. So we don't have exports and imports. This is a closed economy model. We do not have government here right now. So we don't have government spending. We do not have motive for investment here because this is just a one period word. Neydi? Carpe diem. Seize the day. So, or hayat bir gün, o da bugün. Life is only one day long and it's today. Okay, so, and that there is no motive for investment for the second period because there is no tomorrow. There is no second period. So that's why in this very stupid and simplified word, consumption is equal to output. And consumption is equal to output. So these two equations. Now, actually, the complete characterization of the competitive equilibrium basically involve these two equations. Because again, for competitive equilibrium, we actually need two unknowns. What are these two unknowns? Consumption, leisure. You might tend to think that labor is also an unknown because, you know, and if you go back to the definition of competitive equilibrium, we need to find out consumption, we need to find out leisure, we need to find out labor. But labor is not a truly an unknown because labor is equal to H minus leisure. Since H is given, once you know leisure, you automatically know labor. So it's not truly an unknown that enters into the first order condition. And what about these? These are also unknowns, but once you know labor, you know this. Capital is already given. And once you know, once you know capital and labor, since you know the formula for the production function, output is immediately known. So there is no really an unknown here. So the two unknowns in this one period model, if we have two period, three period model, the number of unknowns is going to increase. We'll see. But in this very simple one period model, the number of unknowns is two. Therefore, we need two equations here. Yeah? And these two equations here are now these two. The first one, intratemporal condition with a slight modification that W is now equal to this. The second one is this, consumption is equal to output. Of course, W is also an unknown. R is also an unknown. But W you can always calculate. If you know the value of M, W you can automatically calculate. R, since you already know the value of K, you can automatically calculate. So all the other unknowns can easily be obtained through the remaining equation. So the two truly unknowns are consumption and leisure, actually. And for them, we can use these two equations. There is an example here. Again, we have this production utility function, Cobb-Douglas utility. H is 14, Cobb-Douglas production function. Z0 is normalized to 1. K0 is given to be 1,225 square of 35. The question is find competitive equilibrium values. So first, you calculate the marginal products, the partial derivatives with respect to K and N, So just do it for marginal product of labor first. And then the production function is given by this, but replace the constant value of z0 and k0 into the production function. Then the production function simplifies. This is z0, this is k0. k0 to the power of 1 over 2 square root of k0 is 35. So 35 times n to the power of 1 over 2 is our production function. Marginal products, we can then rewrite. Now, let's write the intratemporal condition. 3.10 is the intratemporal condition. This is u sub l, the partial derivative of the utility function with respect to leisure, times marginal product of labor here, times partial derivative of the utility function with respect to consumption. Okay, simplify it a little bit. It simplifies to this. Okay, it simplifies to this. Then, so this is the intratemporal condition. Remember the second, we have written 3.10. We need another equation. This is going to be 3.11. Consumption is equal to output. That comes next, actually. So this is our intratemporal condition. And consumption is equal to output condition is given by this. This is output. This is consumption. Okay. Now, as you can see from here, C0 is equal to this expression. From here, C0 is equal to this expression. Let's just equate them. So C0 from the intratemporal condition is equal to C0 from the goods market equilibrium condition. And then if you simplify, get rid of the N0s, or get N0 to the right-hand side and cancel the 35s, you have L0 is equal to 2N0. And since L0 and N0 add up to H, which is 14, you can just combine the two and calculate L0. L0 turns out to be 28 divided by 3, 9.3, roughly. And N0 is simply 4.66. So once you know N0, once you know L0, the rest immediately follows. C0, you can calculate from N0. It turns out to be 75 point something. W0, you can calculate from marginal product of labor because W0 is equal to marginal product of labor. So you can just calculate it's 8.10. R0 from marginal product of capital, 0.03. Output, you can calculate through the production function, 75.6. And as you can see, output is equal to consumption, not surprisingly. Okay. Any questions so far? This concludes lecture zero. Oh no, sorry, lecture one. Okay. Yok mu soru? Any questions? Last call for questions. Otherwise, I will start lecture two. We are going to end at around 11:45 or so, but I need to start with lecture two a little bit. Hızlı mı gidiyor? So, do we proceed very fast, very slow, right on the pace, Can you follow or do you have difficulties to follow what I'm talking about? Feedback verin arkadaşlar. Give me feedback a little bit. Bir şey söyleyin.
In my opinion, everything is fine.
Okay, güzel. Duymak istediğim cümleler bunlar. Yok tabii, şaka söylüyorum. Daha bunları söyle. Böyle konuşmak zorunda değilsiniz. Yanlış anlamayın. Of course, you can criticize me and you can also ask any questions and if you need any clarifications, please don't hesitate. Okay, peki. Now let's start lecture two. Lecture two is now going to be slightly extending the previous model now in a two-period world. Of course, it's also going to be making it more realistic, but in economic theory, there is always a trade-off between realism and simplicity. So if you make things more realistic, of course, at the same time, you make them more complicated and vice versa. okay, if you don't have any questions. Now it's going to be a two-period world where we have now a household or a firm living for two periods. Of course, when you say two periods, don't just sort of misunderstand, like don't just assume that here each period is a, you can just tend to say like, you know, oh, it's a two-period world. It is very unrealistic because in the real world, we have, of course, more than two periods. Yeah, maybe, but for example, here you can just make the assumption that each period corresponds to a period of 35 years. Then 70 years is roughly the average life expectancy, more or less, in the world. So, you know, it can be realistic in that sense. So it, just that, just because that this model is a two-period model does not really make it unrealistic from the point of time. It can be still realistic if you assume that each period corresponds to a period of 35 years. Arkadaşlar kusura bakmayın. Duyuyor musunuz beni şu anda? Duymuyorsunuz. Duyuyor musunuz?
Duyuyoruz hocam.
Hop dedi gitti okula. Yani evden de bağlanmıyorum orada. Okuldan bağlanıyorum sevgili okulumuzdan. İnternet bir, tamamen gitti böyle bir anda bir süreliğine. Tekrar geri geldi sonra. So, I lost my Wi-Fi connection. Burada herkes... Ha, şey nerede burada? Kolbi yok. Ben de İngilizce konuşuyorum ama... tamam şu an biz... Ha, buradasın pardon özür dilerim. Tamam kusura bakma Kolbi ben görmedim seni. I'm sorry, so I lost my Wi-Fi connection. I don't know. For I'm now in my office in the Natuk Pirkan building, and the Wi-Fi connection suddenly got lost. So that's why I dropped from the session. Maybe now it's maybe, oh, now my annotation tool is back. So maybe it's a good thing that I had to drop from the session, because now I can use annotation tool. Okay, so where was, so I think I was left here. So we are basically considering a two-period work in which the household receives utility in both periods. However, it discounts future utility, because generally there is this underlying assumption that when people want to consume things, when people want to enjoy things, they want to enjoy it as early as possible. If I just give you two chances, you know, you are going to get $1 million today, $1 million 10 years from today, most likely you will prefer receiving it now. Or again, similar to leisure. So we are always discounting future utility stream, so to speak. And that discount is basically symbolized by this letter beta, which takes a value between 0 and 1. Theoretically, it can be as large as 1, but most of the time we assume it's equal to, it is less than 1, sorry. It is less than 1. And you are going to basically do a simulation, calibration exercise, where we are going to be calibrating this parameter for a number of countries, including Turkey. You will also see from there that it's going to be less than 1. Okay, so this is one. And also another implicit assumption here is that the utility function is time separable. Time separable means we can write the utility function separated by time. It's not like, you know, if we had a product sign here instead of a summation sign, then it would be non-separable. But here it's separable now, time separable. Or sometimes, you know, you could have a more complicated utility function where different times enter the utility functions different. So we are not assuming this kind of complicated utility functions, basically. Okay. And other than that, it's going to be the same. The household has an initial capital endowment K0. But of course, now there will be motive for saving, because now there is a tomorrow, as you'll see. So there will be some motive for savings or investment. You can arguably think of it that way at the same time. Yes, and this beta factor also is, you know, interpreted to be a patience versus impatience factor, because if your beta is large, it means that you are a patient individual. If your beta is small, it basically is a degree of impatience, so to speak. You can also interpret it with rho. Generally, beta is tied to the market interest rate, but this is not really very important right now. Now, an important issue here is the following. So now it's a two-period world. In the first period, you are already in the beginning, you are already endowed with K0. And with your K0, you can rent your K0 to the firm, and the firm can use it for the production. But now when K0 or capital is used for production, it loses some value. This is called depreciation, because it's called like machinery equipment getting older, losing value, you know, worn out capital, you know, generally. Right now, for example, here, I am producing a teaching service. It's also a production, not production of a good, but production of a service. Right now, when I am teaching to you, I am producing a teaching service. And for this, I am using my laptop computer. And, you know, I'm using my laptop computer, that the computer is my capital. And of course, when I use it throughout the semester, when I use it throughout the academic year, you know, it depreciates. That depreciation is denoted by the depreciation rate. And with the delta, delta or D, it doesn't, I don't differentiate between them. I think we are going to use D from now on. So it's D. It's again a number between 0 and 1, depreciation rate. Generally, you know, the annual depreciation rate for economies is said to be between 4% to 8%. But it's basically the process of capital losing value when it is used in production. Now, therefore, now the household, since it's a two-period model, we now allow household to make investment decisions to increase the initial capital stock. And this investment process basically is illustrated by this law of motion for capital. That's the equation that shows the law of motion for capital. And that's a very intuitive accounting equation. It basically tells us that so initially we have K0, that K0 is used in production, and D fraction or delta fraction, D fraction of K0 depreciates over the year or over the period when it is used in production. And 1 minus D fraction remains. But on top of that, throughout the year, we also make new investment for capital. Therefore, in the beginning of the second year, we are now end up with K1 that we can now rent to the firm in the second period. Is this clear to everyone, this capital accumulation process?
Hocam, why it's called law of motion?
Because, you know, it's, yani niye law of motion? Ne bileyim, motion. It illustrates the motion. Ne demek? Motion means movement, right? So it basically illustrates the movement of capital from one period to another. Okay? This is for period. So I in period zero, I am endowed with K0. I rent it to the firm. D fraction depreciates. 1 minus D fraction remains. I make this investment. In the beginning of the next period, second period, remember, second period is period 1, since first period is period 0. In the beginning of the second period, I am endowed with this. Now, what happens in this period? In this period, again, I rent it to the firm. The firm uses it. D fraction gets away, and you just are endowed with 1 minus D fraction at the end of the period 1. But now there is no tomorrow, so you don't invest for period 2 because there is no period 2. What do you do with this remaining capital? You eat it. Or you convert it to consumption in a 1-to-1 ratio. That's the assumption. Again, in period 1, which is the second period, A1 is being used in production. At the end of the period, 1 minus D times K1 remains. And the household basically, at the very end, before the world is over, before we come to the end of the world, the household converts it to consumption. That's the assumption here. Why do I explain this? Because these are going to show up in the constraints in a minute. So it's just read that after the firm uses the capital, it returns the remaining stock to the household. However, the household has no further need for this asset because we are now approaching to the end of the world. As the world ends in that period, since K does not enter into utility function, it makes no sense to have a positive capital stock. Hence, we assume that the household can transform capital to consumption on a 1-to-1 ratio. Where do I going to see it mathematically? Here, now in this two budget constraints. Now, since it's a two-period world, for each period, there will be a separate budget constraint. One for period zero, another one for period one. Now, so the period zero budget constraint is this one. So the period zero income is the same as before, labor income plus capital income. But now the left-hand side is different compared to previous lecture notes. Why? Because now the household does not only consume, but it also invests. And for period one, the spending side is just consuming because there is no tomorrow now. There is no third period. So therefore, the whole income is consumed. We have labor income. Of course, you know, now W1 is different than W0. L1 is potentially different than L0. And we have R1, K1, capital income. And then this is basically eating the remaining capital at the end. And summing up, the utility maximization problem now becomes this. Maximizing utility subject to two budget constraints, capital accumulation equation, non-negativity of consumption, non-negativity of leisure, as well as leisure cannot be beyond H, above H, and non-negativity of capital in the second period. And look at the unknowns here. C0, C1, L0, L1, and I0. It can be I0 or K1 because, you know, if you look at the capital accumulation equation, so K0 is given. Delta is given. So either the unknown is I0 or K1, because once you know I0, you automatically know K1. Or once you know K1, you automatically know I0. So it doesn't mean, we don't need to differentiate between I0 and K1 as if they are two different unknowns. Actually, there is only one unknown. Either I0, you can just write it as I0 or K1. But what's more important is that there is now five unknowns here. Therefore, we need how many equations? Five equations. It's going to be a system of five equations and five unknowns. In a three-period work, it's going to be eight equations and eight unknowns. Actually, you are going to see there's a formula, 3t plus 2. So the number of the end period times 3 plus 2. So if we have a model with going on from period 0 to period 51, it's going to be 51 times 3. 153 plus 2, 155 equations and 155 unknowns. You can, you know, this model, the five equations, five unknowns, you can solve numerically, you know, you can solve on your own using, you know, a pen and pencil. But from a three-period model onwards, it gets really messy. That is why later on, when we increase the number of periods to any arbitrary number, 55, 132, whatever, we are going to be using a computational software and we are going to be using a computational code that's going to do the job for us. But now it's a five equations, five unknowns model. Okay? And again, as I say, so these are the equations and, you know, now a few more minutes, just let's look at the characterization and I'm going to stop here. I am going to continue from here next time, but in the characterization of the model, now we are, so it's difficult to do it with MRS and, you know, indifference curves with this logical. So right now we are going to be more formal and we are going to be basically forming a Lagrangian. But before writing down the Lagrangian, as I have told you, you know, it doesn't matter whether you view I0 as the unknown or K1 as the unknown. What we are going to do is that we will be taking this law of motion for capital. Şimdi burada artık annotate'imi kullanabilirim. Allah vallahi tam kendimi bulacağım şimdi. Evet, now I can now take this capital accumulation equation. Çok da kötü kullan ama now I can plug into here. Okay? So wherever I see I0, I can basically see zero. So this is now nothing but I0. But instead of I0, now I'm writing it at K1 minus 1 minus DK0. Why am I doing that? Because I will take derivative not with respect to I0, instead I will be taking derivative with respect to K1, because either I0 is the choice variable or K1 is the choice variable. Because as I told you, once you know I0, you automatically know K1. Once you know K1, you automatically know I0. So it doesn't matter which one you use as the choice variable. And the tradition is using K as the choice variable. So now what's going to happen is, şunu sileyim. Now what's going to happen is basically we are now forming our Lagrangian here. And the Lagrangian, as you know, the objective function times so plus multiplier times first constraint, another multiplier times the second constraint, the budget constraints. And what you do is that you take first order condition with respect to the choice variables and then the multipliers. Of course, if you take the first order condition with respect to multipliers, you just get back the constraints satisfied through equality. Now, if you take derivative, partial derivative, with respect to the choice variables here, so you take the, you basically you get these five equations. The first equation with respect to C0 is equal to, you know, U sub C is equal to L0, U sub L is equal to W times, not L0, lambda 0. With respect to C1, you have beta here, like, but just standard first order conditions. And for K1, if you take partial derivative with respect to K1, K1 shows up in both constraints. Therefore, so it gives you minus lambda 0 from here, and then This is the expression here. Plus lambda 1 times 1 minus d r1 here. So it basically is an equation that has both lambda 0 and lambda 1. And that's going to help us to combine all these equations into one. Okay. Is this clear to everyone? Just let us combine them very quickly. Now, if you combine 1.2 with 1.3, so if you combine these two equations, how can you combine them? Where you see lambda 0 in 1.3 here, just plug in what lambda 0 is equal to. And you see this equation now. And then similarly for 1.4 and 1.5. Bu şurada bir hata var. Şunun 1.5 olması lazım. Şurayı düzeltelim. Şu yanlış. Bunun 1.5 olması gerekiyor. When you do this, then what happens is that you get these two intratemporal conditions. So as you can see, for all periods, even if it's a 51 period model, for every period you will have this intratemporal condition. So the first one is the intratemporal condition for period zero. What was the intratemporal condition? The trade-off that the household is facing. Should I supply one more unit of labor or not? If I do that, I get this, but I got this. This is the trade-off. And the similar trade-off for period one. So in each period, the household faces the trade-off of supplying one more or one less unit of labor. Then, burada da bir typo olabilir. If you now combine 1.2, 1.4 and 1.6. Burada yanlış 1.5 diyor. Bunda 1.6 olması lazım. Şu ikisinin yer değiştirmesi gerekiyor. Pardon. Bu 1.6 olacak. If you combine, how do you combine? So look at this. In 1.6 you have lambda 0. So wherever you see lambda 0, put 1.2. In 1.6 you have lambda 1. Wherever you see lambda 1, put 1.4. If you do that, now you have this new equation. And this equation is going to be named as intertemporal equation. Intertemporal. Why? Because now it's an equation that involves, it's intertemporal means between time. Why between time? Because you see, here we have period 0 as well as period 1 in the same equation. Sometimes it's also called the Euler equation, by the way, but intertemporal is a more common use phrase. And guess what? Intertemporal equation also illustrates a trade-off. Because now it's a two-period model. In addition to this supplying one more or one less unit of labor trade-off, the households face another trade-off. It's the following. Should I now, in period zero, should I consume one more unit today? Or instead, should I invest and then consume more tomorrow? If I consume one more unit today, I get this. If I instead consume one unit less today and invest it to tomorrow, I get this, I get capital, I rent the capital and earn this, and then I also enjoy this, eat out this remaining capital, and I convert it to this much consumption, and that consumption brings me this much utility, but of course I discount future utility. So if I consume one unit less today, I lose this, I gain this. In equilibrium, they should be equal, or in if this is a utility maximization problem being solved, they should be equal. If they are not equal, I was not maximizing utility in the first place. So this is a trade-off that the household is facing here.